Now I'd like to turn it over to Dr. Paxton Bock. Paxton is a clinical assistant professor in the Department of Medicine at the University of British Columbia and a general internist and addiction medicine physician at St. Paul's Hospital in Vancouver, BC, and a whole bunch of other things that I won't get into, so we can just turn it over to Paxton. Go ahead, Paxton.
I really appreciate the invitation to be here and the work you put into organizing this. And it's an honor to be here with colleagues of mine who I have so much respect for around the country. And I really feel like I don't have a lot to add from what has been said already, but I'll still give you my pitch. But it's very gratifying, I think, to be a part of this and to see this because I spend so much of my time talking about the overdose crisis as something called a wicked problem, meaning a complicated problem that is composed of many other very complex problems, each of which is evolving and changing at its own space, and each of which really looks different depending on what community, what population, what geographic region of the country you're talking about. The overdose crisis could almost be thought of as, 1,000 different versions of the same story. And so when we talk about the need for a comprehensive response, I think that's a theme that's been cutting through all of the talks today, that there is no single response that will ever address all of those contributors to the overdose crisis. And it's so important to, I think, be open-minded and listen to all of the other options, and then as Jeff has highlighted, really look at what's needed in any given community or context as to where the priorities and the needs are. And so I appreciate that you're doing that. It's been many years since I've been to Waterloo, so I can't tell you what is going to be right for your community, but I can talk a little bit about our experience in BC. And to be clear, I'm an addiction physician. I work at St. Paul's Hospital. I spend an inordinate amount of my time working with patients with an opioid use disorder who often have suffered many overdoses, and I'm very much engaged in a lot of these different topics that have come up. I am going to talk today a little bit about safer supply specifically. That's what I was sort of asked to do, and really, I think a lot of what I'm saying has already been stated by Rebecca. But I will restate some of it because I think it's important. It's important to understand some of these ideas and principles. So my disclosures, like I said, I am a physician. I work in Vancouver. One of my disclosures is I work in Vancouver. I work in an urban setting on the West Coast. It's very different from a rural setting on the East Coast. That informs my opinions and my priorities. I am this is a mouthful, but I was one of the contributors to what is infamously called the Safe Supply Guideline. It was the first piece of clinical guidance that talked about how these medications might be used for the prevention of overdoses. And I prescribe a whole host of medications and non-medication options for people suffering a variety of substance use disorders. I do prescribe safer supply for some people sometimes, depending on the situation. And I can talk a little bit about that clinical experience. So those are my disclosures, really my context. This has already been kind of highlighted by Rebecca, but I'm going to go back to it because I think it's really important to be specific when we're having these conversations. There is so much conflating of different issues and different topics and different responses that I think it's really important that we be specific as to what we're talking about when we are having these conversations. When we're talking about safer supply, this is the definition provided by Health Canada, providing prescribed medications as a safer alternative to the toxic illegal drug supply to people who are at high risk of overdose. It's a bit of a mouthful, but I think it's rather easily understood. Put it differently, the Drug User Liberation Front is a group of advocates based out of Vancouver who have been real outspoken advocates and pioneers, I think, in this space. And their definition is a little bit more straightforward. It's presently illegal drugs sold legally with predictable content and consistency, or some version of that. So what I am talking about today, when I talk about safer supply, is our current system that has been adopted in Canada that is prescriber-based. All access comes by seeing a physician first. Hydromorphone programs, the 97% of the safe supply in BC is hydromorphone, which is a particular type of opioid. This is just one example of what the execution of a safe supply program might look like. So there's lots we can learn from it. There's lots to say, I think, positively about experience, lots of criticism there. This is not the be-all end-all for safe supply. That's a much bigger concept, but I'm going to be talking about the way it's being currently delivered in BC. Really, the key questions when I talk to policymakers, when I talk to fellow physicians, when I talk to really anyone about the subject, the key questions can be distilled down to two things. And to be clear, these are not mutually exclusive things, they are two different questions. So the answers are not necessarily contingent on one another. The first is prescribed safer supply actually effective at reducing overdose deaths and other consequences of an increasing toxic drug supply? I.e., does this work? Can this be an effective tool as a part of a broad comprehensive response? The second question, which is very important and related but distinctly different, is what are the potential and actual unintended consequences of prescribed safer supply policy? I.e., are there harms? And what might those be, and how do we measure those? And we can actually talk about each of those questions. We can talk about the data that what we know about each of them. So as far as does it work, this is a question we can speak to based on some evidence with some comfort. And there's certain things that I think we can say we know. So what we know, I feel silly talking about this because one of the authors of the ODPRN review is with us, but there was a review done in Ontario of 20 different publications on this topic, some peer-reviewed studies and some programmatic evaluations, looking at kind of the summary of what we know in this space that came out last year, which summarized, to put it really quite succinctly, looking across all the literature, a possible decrease in fatal opioid toxicity events, emergency department visits, hospitalizations, and many self-reported improvements in things like physical and mental health and quality of life from participants in these programs. We can back those studies up with two recent publications that came from BC. I should also disclose that I was one of the researchers on both of these publications. But it was looking across BC at the first 2 years of our policy. What were the effects on people who were receiving these substances, these prescribed substances? There was up to a 91% decreased risk of all-cause mortality in people receiving these medications this is sort of 2019 to 2021. And a significantly increased likelihood of people accessing and remaining on OAT or opiate agonist treatment, what I previously mentioned is the gold standard treatment for opioid use disorder. So it actually, it doesn't have to be contrasted with methadone or suboxone. It can actually and often is quite complementary with those medications. Just speaking to one of the questions that was in the chat. So the summary of what we know is we have limited data, but in general, I think it paints a picture that at least some people, some of the time, can very likely benefit from this. This can be a helpful intervention, as best as we can tell based on existing publications. Really important, we all acknowledge what we don't know. We don't actually really understand the mechanism or mechanisms of effect, and there's been lots of different things proposed. And realistically, it probably helps different people in different ways, and that's okay, because the end result will be the same. We don't really know much about longer term effectiveness of this approach because we haven't been doing this for very long. And we don't really understand how it interacts with existing treatments in the treatment system. As I mentioned, in the short term, people who are on these medications have a dramatically increased likelihood of accessing other forms of more conventional treatment. But there's certainly lots of questions for us to still learn in this area of does it work? In a word, probably or almost certainly for some people some of the time, this can be helpful. It is very important, though, as already highlighted, to ask the other questions, are there harms or other unintended consequences that we need to be considering when designing these programs? And this is where things get trickier. And we're a little more limited in our data, but there's certain things we can identify and speak to. So in BC, there has been much attention paid to reports of increased rates of addiction. There's been many media articles, there's been many physicians talking about of what they see as likely cases of opioid use disorder caused by these programs, especially in youth. This is a common narrative. However, we also have surveillance data from the CD, from the Center for Disease Control here, looking at diagnosis rates of these of opioid use disorder, looking at admissions to hospital and detox facilities. We have corner data from the corner looking at actually actually, unfortunately, deaths and causes of death. And we don't see that picture there. We don't see spikes in these related to safe supply prescribed. We don't see it in any of our surveillance data. That's not to say that I'm not disregarding this. It's really important we understand this question. But when we try and reconcile these clinical anecdotes we're hearing with the surveillance data that we have, we are left at a bit of an impasse. And I think that we need to center the data in these conversations as much as possible, because that's the best thing that we can rely on. Similarly, there has been reports and in fact some data suggesting that perhaps there have been increase in opioid-related hospitalizations since the pandemic and since the rolling out of these policies. It's really not clear though. Much has changed, as you're all aware, in the last few years. It has been a tumultuous time in Canada for so many reasons. So the causes or implications of this and whether it truly can be attributed to these programs or not is very murky, but warrants close attention and many more and much more study. There's certainly a report of increased hydromorphone seizures across Canada from the RCMP. We hear that frequently, and I think that that's legitimate. There's as has been mentioned, we know that diversion of these substances is happening to a certain extent, that may be sharing with neighbors or friends or family, and that may be more coordinated selling of these substances. And we are starting to see hydromorphone show up in some seizures, and that is troubling. However, it's also really important that we contextualize that and recognize that the vast majority of opioid seizures in the country, the vast majority, remain fentanyl. And so whether or not hydromorphone seizure rates have increased, and they very well may have, it is a drop in the bucket compared to overall opioid trafficking seizures, and that data has been presented by the RCMP. So, it remains to ask what other the potential we have termed second order effects or kind of unintended consequences, and how do we better monitor for these? This is a critical question for researchers across the country you're asking and looking into. As it stands, there are certainly many reasons to be on attention, but I don't believe that we have any concrete data suggesting that any of these harms are really clearly evident or on the rise. Now, that's a very quick summary of the data. I wanted to talk a little bit about kind of my role as a physician, what this means to me, and what does it look like through a clinical lens. And I can tell you that this is, to me, this is another tool. This is another tool in a very, very empty toolbox that I have when I'm treating opioid use disorder and trying to prevent overdoses. I have some very, very effective medications like methadone and Suboxone that can work wonders for patients. I've seen the transformative effects of those medications on many people that I've seen over the years. However, there are many situations where those medications are not desired or effective or sufficient, and I rapidly run out of room. Hydromorphone has been another tool in my toolbox, a tool that for some people I do see really transformative effects, and for others I see it being wildly ineffective. And I would suggest that as a form of safe supply, this is probably not the place where you should be devoting the majority of our attention and investment. But as a tool in my toolbox, as a clinician, I value it. I see really significant benefits in some of my patients, and I think that. But I think that again, this must be contextualized in a broader picture of recognizing our response from treatment to harm reduction to addressing upstream drivers of substance use disorders has been inadequate. Clearly, I'm not saying that to condemn any particular political party or anything. That's an indictment of our work as well. It is clearly inadequate because people keep dying. And it is critical that we do better.
I think you might have referred to this earlier. There was a lady named Erica that was asking about why safer supply drugs work for some when methadone doesn't. But then there was some further discussion, and then I think she was clarifying her thought. And what she was saying is, because you're a clinician, I thought you might be able to assist here. I guess what I was asking is whether there is a high with one, because there's whether safe supply works for some and methadone works for others, if there's a difference there. Is there a high with one and not the other, which could mean that maybe the use of one versus the other could have to do with someone's readiness for change slash treatment? She was just curious about that. So.
Yeah. I mean, it's a complicated question. But the short answer is, I think that she is correct. I want to be clear that, again, they're not mutually exclusive things. They serve they serve.
Right.
It's going to depend on an individual. Methadone is designed to give people a very steady dose of a very long acting opiate over time to kind of to alleviate those peaks and valleys of an opiate use disorder, those periods of extreme intoxication and withdrawal and kind of the uncontrolled use, et cetera, that and consequences that accompany that. And methadone is very effective at that for many people. Methadone also has real significant drawbacks. It takes weeks or even months to get people to an effective dose of methadone. But it may take months, all the while they will be continuing to use because they're at subtherapeutic doses. So in some circumstances, the hydromorphone can be an extraordinarily effective adjunct there to give them a more predictable alternative to be accessing, rather than the unpredictable drug supply while we are finding the range for their methadone. For others, it may not be about the subtherapeutic dose of methadone. They may be looking for. It may be about kind of like where somebody's at and where their goals are, and they perhaps may not be in a place where where giving up on using drugs entirely is reasonable to them in the short run, in the short term, or it may not be their desire in the short term, whether or not whatever the long term goals will be. I see many people who are really active, like very tired and really want to make change, but they've also been using drugs every day for 40 years. So to
Right.
immediately stop is a very jarring thing. That's a deeply ingrained part of their lifestyle. And so it may be a bridge to that, where it's a substance that they can use from a, suppose you'd say, more recreational standpoint, but it's predictable. It is known. It is a known entity. And you contrast that, as already been alluded to, the I can't overstate how unpredictable the current drug supply is, where people will, if depending on day to day, where they get the drugs, they may very easily hit some bad dope and black out for 3 days at a time. They may wake up in a different city and not know how they got there. They may wake up in hospital and not know how they got there, or just the cumulative effect of that unpredictable substances on people's just cognition and ability to make their way through the day can be very unpredictable and really, really distressing and really, really harmful. I could go on, but
Right.
they're not mutually exclusive things. For many, they do serve different roles. The critical question that I'm asking with every patient every day is, what can I do to keep you from accessing fentanyl tomorrow, from potentially dying tomorrow? And then let's work from there.
Right. Somebody asked a question early on, whether the difference between if there's a drug overdose versus drug poisoning. Are you able to assist with that, what those phrases refer to, or or someone else could jump?
I can speak. I'm sure any of us can speak to that. I think the term drug poisoning has become more commonly used to recognize the fact that what is killing people is not it's not necessarily addiction that is out of control. It is not necessary. It's not necessarily related to a loss. The characteristics of addiction that we describe, like loss of control and compulsive use, so much as it is. The extreme variability in the drug supply, and the fact that that anyone out there, whether this is your first time or your 10,000th time using, if you hit a bad batch of drugs, you might die. You might. So the drug supply is so volatile and contaminated that for many that it can be considered a poisoning because they're not getting what they think they're getting. They're trying to use as they normally would, and then they die because it's filled with benzodiazepines or xylazine or metatomidine or just exceptionally high doses of fentanyl and carfentanil and, innumerable other substances which are showing up in completely unpredictable ways.
I just wondered also, Paxton, brought this up a few times. How do we help those three out of four that die alone? I mean, how are we reaching those people? Like, I hear a lot about the substance abuse people that with the addiction. We're not talking about those three or four necessarily as substance abusers, right? I mean, how are we finding them and helping them?
Well, I mean, I think you could go around the horn for to each of us for that question. I think the shortest answer, but perhaps the least satisfactory one, is really talking about stigma and why people are using it alone. That's not that's a that's a you know somewhat of a of a murky answer and not something that is easily corrected. But why are people using it alone? Oftentimes because we have made that the best available option to them through. Through lack of access to resources or through stigma, that is where they find themselves. Whether or not that's a substance use disorder or not, whether they're using recreationally or not, like there's many, many different versions of that.
All right, Paxton, thank you very much.